I heard you say a couple of things in our discussion today. One, this idea of having to have passion, persistence, perseverance. I love this idea of, you know, making sure that a person delivers what they promise. I think that's a forgotten characteristic in this day and age. I love this idea that kept coming up, that when you sit with clients, that will drive change if you have a problem solver mentality. Right. I definitely will walk away thinking about this continuous execution and process implementation at scale and how using that will help drive an organization. In leadership, I think many organizations forget that at the end of the day, treating people like human beings is the most important leadership characteristic. And I love this idea of looking at life in the context of spokes in a wheel and making sure that they're balanced. So I personally have learned a lot from our conversation today, Mr. Ramesh, and I just want to say thank you very much for sharing your time and wisdom with us today. Great. I'm excited for today's episode of Talks with T. I'm very honored to have Mr. Ramesh Ramakrishnan on the show. I'd say forefather or founder of Transworld and chairman today. Thank you for joining us on the show.
Thank you very much, Tariq, and for giving me an opportunity to speak to you.
Thanks. I'm really looking forward to the discussion. I guess for anyone who's living under a rock and doesn't know what Transworld is, can you please at least give an introduction to the company?
Yeah, most certainly. I'll try and keep it as brief as possible. You know, the Transworld started off in the year 1977. It's a story where my father was the one who started this business. He, like a lot of Indians, was advised to look for greener pastures. And that is what was the instigation, that was his encouragement to go to Kuwait in the early 60s. And he started off working as a stenographer in those days, you know, the ones who type mails, et cetera, et cetera. That was his primary job. And on the job, he learned a lot about the industry and how things work, et cetera. Then he got an opportunity to move into Dubai in the early 70s, actually. And he then had the vision to start up a small agency business way back in the year 1977 in Bombay. And we were the shipping agents for a container company called Conship. And that used to come to Dubai and then go to Iran and go back. So he had the foresight in suggesting to them that they should go in into India and try and see what they could do and get started. And that was the beginning of the business. Unfortunately, you know, he sort of passed away in the year 1989 when he was hardly 57 years of age. Now, I was absolutely in the business right from the day one in 1977 when I was a young kid of 16 and 17. Bombay as a city, or India especially in Bombay, gives you a golden opportunity to essentially go to your college in the mornings. And you finish your college by about 10 or 10:30. And the rest of the time, you're spending all your time getting into your work. You had an ability to go and start investing money into the stock markets. Maybe it's 10 rupees to 100 rupees, whatever you make, either singly or collectively with a few friends. Gave you a great insight into how you sort of establish something and start creating something over a period of time. That was the sort of start. And since he passed away in 1989, I moved to Dubai in 1989. We were a very small fledgling company even at that time. We had one ship and we had a few containers in our fleet and an office in Bombay and a small little agency set up in Dubai. Now, those were very challenging days. You see, as always, when the new replaces the old, there's always a scenario where you want to do things in a very different manner.
Yeah,
and you find that there's hardly anyone who's sitting with you to try and help you, you know, who tries to sort of understand your vision of what you want to do. And that's about the time you sit down and start setting up your own plans, and you are actually strangled like most startups would be, or most beginners would be, strangled for cash. You'll find that the banks or the people with who you deal with essentially don't understand what you're trying to communicate with them. But it's an uphill task, actually. But then that's the golden opportunity that's lying there in store for you. So I sort of discussed with our senior leadership at that time here, who was actually virtually handholding me to sort of grow the business. It was a gentleman by the name of Mr. Kulas, who was associated at that time with my father. And subsequently, after he passed away, he was also sort of handholding me and sort of molding me in the way things had to be looked at. But again, as I was very young at that time, I was hardly 23 or 24 when I sort of got into this. There was a fire in you to say that this is not the way, it has to sort of grow in a much, much bigger manner. So as a result, we started thinking about developing the agency model in a very big way. And that essentially meant that you are connecting yourself with a lot of clients. You understand the client's expectation and you try and create products just as he wants you to do. And as you kept doing that, I must say that by the year it was 1995, or you know, almost close to the end of the century, we, I must say creditably, we were, under my leadership, were almost the, arguably the number one privately held shipping agency group in India. Almost close to 15 to 20% of whatever traffic came in and went out used to be through our organization. That's on one side. And then when I moved in 89, we had one ship here and a few containers here. There was a burning need at that time for lines or shipping companies coming in here wanting to carry back, because there was nothing that they could take back from this part of the world. So they always wanted to take back something to on their ships. So we suggested that you come in here and we'll start running a smaller ship into India, try and bring the export business from here, give it to you, transship it in Port Rashid in Dubai, and then take over to wherever you go to, whether it's Europe or the Mediterranean or Africa or wherever it is. That was the kind of start that we created. And then, of course, today as we speak, we are greatly involved. We own under our group close to about 35 ships. These are container ships, bulk carriers, and also tankers. Incidentally, today is the day, you know, that's why I was saying that we need to, I need to go back a bit early, because we have a closing and we are buying the first of our tanker this morning. And we have an acquisition coming up again on Monday as the second tanker that comes into our fleet. So essentially, shipping, ship owning is the core of our business. And way back in the year 2000, we decided that we also cannot be sitting down only with the ships. We expanded ourselves into the NVOCC, which is actually the business that connects our relationship with the customers. It's a B2C business where we have a number of customers who work with us. We provide them with containers. We have our ships. We have a relationship with the terminals here. We give them a complete comprehensive service. And much later in the year 2000, we got into the logistics, supply chain, warehousing, distribution, value addition, transport, you name it all. And that's the kind of space that we have gotten and developed. Today, I must say that as an organization, we have a commendable, let's say, control of the cargo that's coming in from the subcontinent to this area. Close to the market share of about 30-35% is controlled through our organization. So it's been an arduous journey over the years. While today I can say that we own 30 ships, we run so many warehouses, we've got so many things that's working along. But the journey has been extremely exciting, challenging, and yet it's something which has been fulfilled. And there's more to go, obviously. But I think one thing that I want to say, since you mentioned about the human element that's involved in the business, I think nothing is possible unless and until you have a team with you. Unless and until you have a team who have bought into your ideas. And unless and until you have the team who's willing to go all the way with you to sort of fulfill the dream that you've shown them, and then you want them to work along with you to reach that goal. That's something which I can say very proudly, that as a leader, as the chairman of the group, I can very proudly say that I am blessed with a great team, right from my agency business to the ship owning business to the people working on board the ships to the crane or the forklift operators, whoever they are.
Yeah,
we have a phenomenally strong team. And that's my job to build them and make sure that whatever they are in terms of expectations, if you are able to fulfill that, then they work for you and then give everything they have to make sure the goals are reached.
Yeah. Thanks for that overview and that amazing history of the business. You took over at a very young age. And I would say, you know, unfortunately with your father passing so young, you don't necessarily have, I would say, a full-on mentor guiding you. And you spoke about having to lead your own way. So, but it sounds like you also had some, you know, someone that you could lean into who could develop you. And so I would love to get your views on the importance of having a mentor or how you developed yourself at such a young age to take on such a big task for entrepreneurs who are listening, who are early in their journey.
Yeah. You know, I think it's important to reflect. You can call it by any name. You can call it by a mentor. You can call it by a guide. You can do whatever name you want to call it. But the most important thing is, in this journey, you have to always find somebody on who you can confide. You can speak your mind. You can share your thoughts. And I think that's something what truly a mentor would do to you. Handhold you, tell you what is wrong. And the mentor should have the ability to correct you at every step where you're likely to go wrong. You see, what I find today and what I think is most important, three things which I truly believe in.
Yeah.
One is passion, persistence, and three is perseverance. And these three are very important to have in any business, because I find in today's times, this element of patience is missing. You know, everybody wants to grow and create a big business in a very short span of time. And I think at the end of the day, you have to nurture your business. And nurturing takes a lot of time. And this needs to be done with an absolute focused manner. Because I think anything that you try to create against the kind of law of nature, I think it will be very hard for it to sustain on a long-term basis. The foundation is very important. A mentor is extremely important to guide you on a day-to-day manner, or once in a time, once in a week, or once in a month, when you want to go back to and reflect and share your thoughts, what is happening, what's not happening. Somebody is there acting as a mirror to tell you this is the direction that you need to take. I think I cannot tell you how important it is to have a good mentor, a good guide to handhold you in any business or anything, even in your personal lives. It is extremely important to have somebody who can sort of guide you through. This is something which one needs to be lucky. And I think I must say that the mentor can come in any form or shape, you know, because at the end of the day, the journey is yours and you are trying to find out. And at the right time, you will find somebody who's coming to be with you. And that's how this journey goes through. So I must say that it's an extremely important need to have someone to who you can reflect, who can come back to you and guide you in the whole journey.
What were some of the things you learned from your mentor early on in your journey of starting up the company?
I think it was what I learned from my father. And I had the kind of luck to work with him for close to about 13 years in the professional side. I learned a lot from him. I think I would say that he was my first mentor as a father. I think he taught me the importance of hard work. He taught me the importance of integrity. He taught me the importance of sticking to what you have to deliver what you promise. He taught me the values, which is what has been the guiding force for me, my organization, and my family. My children follow it to the T, actually. The importance of being truthful, the importance of leading your organization in a manner that you're not compromising integrity in any form. These are so fundamental in nature, and that has to be stuck to all the times. So he taught me all of these values: importance of hard work, staying focused, being passionate about what you do, etc., etc. And when Mr. Kulas was with me after my father passed away, he taught me, I would go and have, when I say a conversation, it was not a conversation in a manner that we would agree to everything. We used to have heated conversations with the only interest to see how do we take the business forward? How do we end up employing more people? How do we create a larger business? So we'd sit down and talk and talk. Strategization, that was one thing that I learned out of him. We would sit down, discuss strategy, and then plan our tactics. How do we reach our goals? And more importantly, what I would also do at the same time, have the ability to internally introspect. Because I think what is also most important, what I've learned in my life, is you need to have measurable goals. And measurable, and you have to be very, very thorough with it, because you can't be cheating yourself. If you say that this is what I'm going to do, this is what I'm going to achieve, this is what I want to reach, you have to, on a monthly or a quarterly basis, in a transparent manner, look at what you've done. And you have to have the courage to accept that introspection. So that helps you to correct yourself. That helps you to change the direction that you want to take. You know, so introspection, a lot of these. Yeah. So my first mentor was obviously my father. And Kulas helped me in the journey. And together, it gave me a great perspective of how one should build and grow your business.
Yeah.
You know, that's what has helped me to stay focused, anchored, and drive it to the levels where we are today.
Yeah. So you said there's three things that you believe are important in business. So I'd like to talk about each one of them. I'd like to talk about the first one, which is passion.
Yeah.
Why do you believe it's such an important driver for success as an entrepreneur?
Yeah. You know, I think you have to have a fire in your belly all the time, you know, because it's important for you to dream. It's important for you to have a clear goal in your mind, because I think most businesses are first built in your mind. Most of any journey that you want to do, whether it's a journey, a car journey, everything is first in your mind. And I think that's where that kindling of the passion comes in. And you want to do, you know, when you're young, when you want to do a lot of these things, there has to be an enormous level of fire in your belly. And you want to truly believe in yourself and have nothing to stop you from reaching your goals. And that, to me, is passion. And that's something which has to be within you. That the fire has to be in you, and you have to keep dreaming about it. And that comes in only if you have that passion in yourself. Without which, you can be like amongst the others, one amongst the rest. You can just be, I'm not saying that there's anything wrong about it or right about it, but I think it will not give you an ability to sort of dream and make yourself where you want to be in times to come. I mean, I knew what exactly I had to do after a lot of deliberations, thinking, because I was involved right from the age of 16 in the way how businesses is created and done. So I had a very clear idea in my mind. Unfortunately, after my father passed away and at an untimely time, I really had to take the mantle and start yet having a big dream, big passion. And end of the day, that's what drove me to reach where we are. And I think to me, that's so, so important. And that has to be in you internally. And you kindle it all the time.
Yeah.
Even now, I can say that at the age of 61, I still have a huge set of agenda that I want to achieve in my life.
Yeah, that's amazing. The second one you talked about was persistence. What are stories that come to mind for you personally where you had to exhibit persistence in the business?
You know, we are in this business of shaping. And as you know, this industry is highly cyclical. And this is so full of challenges. And I think it's not meant for the weak. You know, you've got to be ready to take on all the challenges. And that persistently following through the principles that you have and not willing to give up. I mean, you're not going to see success every morning.
Yeah.
You're going to have the bad and the good days going together. Or certain days are good, many days are bad. But I think you have to be mentally strong and be persistent and in your belief to think that you are going to reach your goal at the end of the day. Giving up in the middle of a race is no good. And you've got to be absolutely persistent with it and to strongly believe in what you want to achieve. You know, there are many things, like we went through so many hardships in our lives. when we in the early 90s, there was a stage when the banks or the people with who you deal with may not want to support you the way you expect them to support you. But at the same time, you can't be losing sight of what you want to grow.
Mm.
And that's about the time you feel that I have to persist with this. I have to go on with this endlessly because I believe in my vision. I believe in what I want to do.
Mm.
So unless and until one persists, you're not going to reach your goal as well.
Yeah.
I think what is also, as I said at the beginning, what probably is missing in today's generation, in today's approach to things is possibly this approach of building an organization on a long-term basis. And everybody is thinking short, 3 years, 5 years, and 2 years, But if you do not have this value of being persisting yourself with what you do with passion, I doubt whether you will have the ability because you're only thinking of trading a business.
Yeah.
And I think if you want to build a business on a longer term basis, you naturally have to have the passion and you need to persist with this endlessly.
Mm.
And that's what I truly believe in. Success and defeat will come every day, but you need to be persistent with your goal and have that passion to build it up.
Yeah.
That's why I strongly believe and I tell everybody, persistence is most important along with passion.
Mm-hmm. And how do you keep that persistence going? So, let's take the example you talked about in the 90s. It's one obstacle that the business faces. And what have you done for yourself to make sure that you don't let dark thoughts or dark times become the narrative of how you operate?
You see, you need to be proactive and you need to be very focused, actually. Yeah. Dark clouds keep coming every now and then.
Yeah.
Rainy days are there every now and then. But I think if you are persistent and focused in what you do and truly believe in what you're doing, I don't think you need to be sort of looking left or right and get worried about what's happening outside of you.
Yeah.
Outside markets affect your business at some point of time. You can't be obviously in control of it.
Mm.
But as long as you're very proactive, as long as you're very clear, and as long as you're persisting in the way you're doing your business, there's also an opportunity for you to tweak the way you do things.
Mm.
You can always kind of pivot your business.
Mm.
Because I think at the end of the day, the most important thing is to also be very flexible and very nimble in what you do, what you want to do.
Mm.
So this persistently pushing your way forward, and it has to be continuously in you.
Yeah.
And I think I make myself very clear. And to me, most of my people in the organization, in my team, to me, I'm never satisfied with what has been set as a goal 6 months back and if you've achieved it.
Mm.
I have a habit of continually pushing the goalpost ahead till you've reached, and you have to keep pushing yourself even more, even after you've reached what you've set yourself out. So this only comes with absolutely persistently pushing. And I keep myself strongly focused on that. I'm never satisfied.
Yeah.
And this persistence comes out of not being satisfied.
Okay.
You want to keep yourself on and on and on and on and on.
Yeah.
To a point that sometimes you might end up irritating or maybe upsetting people around you.
Yeah, but then that was going to be my next question is how do you manage having that continuous drive, that persistence with the team around you who maybe feels like we accomplished this goal, but now the goalpost just moved?
Yeah, but you see, if you're not setting yourself up for that, I think there's no growth.
Yeah.
And to me, I think if you have to grow, grow as an individual, as part of an organization, and including personally, it's extremely important that you have to set new goals every day.
Yeah.
I think it's a question of not even setting something up for the next 1 year. Every day is a new day. And every day you need to set yourself up very clearly. What am I going to do today? What do I want to achieve tomorrow? So this is something which I don't know whether books can teach you.
Yeah.
I mean, I'm not someone who's gone into a big university and done it's all out of practical experiences. I think it has to be coming in from you, and you have to believe that I have to grow. If you are an individual, you're married, you have a family, you may have a child. You have to provide, and you have to have that kind of a feel even for your family to grow. So you can't have a kid and say, it's okay, you've done, got 100%, you've done well in this, and that's the end of it, you know. You have to keep pushing your goals.
Mm.
To a point, people have to trust you and believe you what you're trying to tell them and what is it that you see ahead in life.
Yeah.
And they have to all rally around you and work towards reaching those goals.
Yeah.
And I think it's important to not, like what I just mentioned a while back, to get them irritated, but you've got to sort of put it to them in a manner that they believe in you and they're all working with you to reach that.
Yeah.
And I kindle myself every day. Mm. There's no escape from that, you know. You've got to set yourself up with new goals.
Mm.
Like I said, at my age, I still want to do so many things and I have a very clear agenda as to what I should be achieving.
Yeah.
I may not achieve all of it,
yeah,
but even if I reach 30 or even 50% of that, I think I would have still done my job well.
Yeah, yeah. You said something earlier about when you were first establishing the business, part of the way you were able to grow was looking at what customers were asking for and then building a solution that would deliver that.
Yeah.
I'd love to learn more about how you approach listening to customers, how you approach building for customers.
Yeah. You see, there's a fundamental difference in the sense some people have the products and you start pushing your product actually.
Mm.
But I found that at some point of time, you see, we could say that I have a ship, you have cargo, you give me, I'll take it for you and deliver it here. That's one way of doing it.
Yeah.
But the other way of doing it is to have all of these that you've created as an ingredient. And then you go up to your client and ask him, what is it that you're challenged with? What is it that you're facing difficulty? For example, I'll give you something what we did many years back.
Mm.
We had a client who would ship, I can't remember what product, but he would ship it in cartons that he would put it into a container. But we found that after we sat and started discussing with him, we found that what he had to do was to reduce the length of his carton by almost 2 inches on each of his carton, or maybe I think 1 inch or something on each of the carton. That actually gave him an ability to add another layer of carton into the container into which he was shipping actually.
Mm.
I'm just giving you one example.
Yeah, yeah.
But I think when you sit down and interact with your client, with your customers, with your vendors, suppliers, what happens is you'll begin to see that everyone has a challenge. Everybody has got something or the other that is actually troubling them to reach or kind of realize the kind of profit that they should be generating. So when you sit down and start talking to your clients, you will change as a provider of a product that you have to a problem solver. I keep telling all our people who go out in the market and start talking to the customers, we are actually problem solvers. And if you start looking at that from that context, you're always going to identify, profit will follow.
Mm.
If you are going to be a solver of a problem to your client, the client is going to be more attached to you, more connected to you. And once he's more closely connected to you, then you can start stitching up many of your offerings together, through which you will make him completely, let's say, sticky with you.
Yeah.
And I think importantly, you have to understand them, what they really want. And that's not an easy exercise too. But I think it's necessary that you sit with them. You understand what they want. For example, recently, if you've been hearing about, there's been a lot of issues in the logistics, in the supply chain management. That's been the talk of the day, actually.
Yeah.
Most of the clients did not have a visibility in terms of the supplier providing them what they want, and also the transit delays that was happening from one port to the other. The ships were full, but therefore not accepting. So nobody had a very clear visibility in terms of what was happening.
Mm.
So we got on to the job of sitting with our clients who have been loyal to us for many years, but they found that they were not really getting what they wanted.
Yeah.
So we sort of set out very clearly. We sat down, created a platform within our organization, started talking to this digital supply chain institute based in the US, started getting our people, getting our clients involved, and started having various workshops, understood. And what we got to know was the kind of transparency, the kind of information the customer was looking forward was not really available, because in a closed kind of a situation where nothing was visible.
Mm-hmm.
So we started getting into and started creating a platform through which every hour or every day we could go back to a client and exactly tell him where his product was. So this is the recent one, but I think every time what we have always done was to sit with our customers and understand their precise requirements and then start structuring products which helps them to build. On the other hand, in the early days, the what you think as a product that you had, you will just go and dump it on your client. And they say, this is what I have. I have a glass. This is what you want to take. You take it and go. But that keeps changing over a period of time. So we have, from the day one, as an organization, we sort of believe that it's important to first understand your client and be closer to him and try and give him what he wants you to solve as his problem. And I think if you are able to deal with that, that will buy a lot of loyalty. That will help your client to stay with you. And I think that's very, very important in any business. Sit with your client, understand his need, and be able to create a solution for him. So we are, we believe in our organization, we are problem solvers and not just simply salesmen.
And when the organization's smaller and I'm the leader driving that, I can imagine it's much easier. But when the organization scales, how do you drive that attitude throughout the company?
You know, see, for over a period of time, there are certain things that we have sort of stuck to. Every Tuesday, we have a review meeting, actually. I mean, I attend most of it. If I don't attend also, it's in a structured manner. Somebody or the other is driving it. But every time what we are looking at is to go on repeatedly saying that we are problem solvers. We have to solve customers' problem. Business will follow. Profits will follow. And this is a mantra that we have sort of set clearly to our organization and to the team. And they all think in that manner. And this takes time. It's not that it's going to happen overnight. But it has to start from the top. And that slowly starts percolating down. And then everybody starts looking at it from that perspective. Yesterday, we had a classic case where there were some shipments that was coming in from Jeddah. You know, the clients decided to road haul the particular consignment from Jeddah into Dubai. And there's a time constraint. It has to be here on Tuesday. But it's still stuck in Jeddah till yesterday. So they reached out to us and said, hey, help us. What do we do? So we set the mechanism going all the way. And we ensured that we spoke to whoever was needed, what was needed in terms of some lashing that was actually missing. Whatever had to be done was done. And I'm happy to say that the containers have started moving from Jeddah by road all the way, hitting the Saudi border tomorrow, and will be here on Sunday. So, you know, the understanding what the clients want when they are stuck, and if you can create a solution to help them and find what exactly they want, and be adapt to their needs and keep doing it, you will find a lot of success and traction along with it. I just gave you one example. There are many, many that I can sort of share with you.
And then how do you ensure that what the client wants in the field, so your team's in the field, problem solving, but then these, if the team is solving for the same problem across geographies or continuously, that in and of itself could potentially become its own product or its own offering. And so how do you make sure that those insights that are happening on the ground as individual touch points make their way up back to the management team to be able to say, what can we learn from this for the future of the business?
I mean, I think you sort of hit the nail, actually. In this journey, when you're trying to find what the customers want and what you're trying to build as against their expectations and what you can offer them, actually, finally, it comes up to the management level and through which you start deciding on the investment decisions. And it's always not possible that you can outsource everything to everyone. Then at some point of time, you decide, for example, we were first a shipping agent. I'll just give you a story how it happens.
Yeah, please, I'd love to hear
it. A shipping agency is where you are acting as an agent for a principal and you are offering a service to carry a product from A to B, actually.
So the principal is the one who actually deals with the client and their...
Principal is the operator of the service.
Okay.
And if you are an agent, you offer the principal's product to your client.
Okay.
And okay. for like an e-agent, you would earn a certain percentage as a fee that you earn. That's how you go. And that's only possible if you had a connection with your client. Then as we went along, we said that we needed to have a ship that we have to run. And if you have to run the ship profitably, you need to also get other clients' cargo on board the ship. Plus, at the same time, if you had something or the other left as a vacant space, you have to try and use it. Then what do you do? Then you can come up with a concept and saying that, oh no, we have to also start buying our own containers. Then you start making sure that every time the ship sails, apart from the other client's cargo, whatever space is available, you're also putting in your own box along with some client's cargo into it, which means that the containers, the ship is going absolutely full in both directions, which obviously means adding to your profitability. The next thing you see is that, oh, the client wants you to do a bit of transportation. He's not going to just bring it to the port. He's going to tell you, listen, you come to my warehouse, come to my factory, go and pick it up, take my stuff, you do all that you have to do. And the next thing, after a while, you think, oh, this is a great business. We should also start having some trucks and trailers to operate the business. You start adding into that. Then the next thing you'll realize that the client wants to have information. He wants to know where is what and what, because ultimately the client wants to reduce his working capital. You know, he doesn't want to go to the bank and start having borrowings and start keeping keeping interest for it. So he wants to know exactly what is happening, which means he wants to buy and sell exactly in a very well-balanced manner so that his cash outflows are not affected. So you start creating a system through which you're informing them. Then you think that, oh, this is not enough. You need to have a warehouse because he wants you to store it here. And then he comes up and tells you, I want you to distribute it to me. Then he comes up and tells you, I want you to invoice my clients and start collecting and start paying to me regularly. So what happens is, when you are looking at it from a service perspective, when you're looking at things from a customer problem solving perspective, gradually it comes up to you. For example, today we have an air freight department, which started off as a service providing to many clients who need the air freight as a product. But I think after a while, after we have created a base, it doesn't end there. I've told my guys that, listen, we have to start having our own aircraft. That should be our goal. In a period of time, in maybe 2 years, in 3 years' time, if you build the base up, you should also start operating your own aircrafts with cargo, of course, not with passengers. But that's the dream that my guy has got, and he's working very hard towards achieving that in the next 2 years. But what are we doing in the process? We are actually providing solutions to clients. So one integrated, elongated platform is what you create. And now in today's times, it doesn't end by just offering these kind of services. Today, digitization is the way things are happening. You should be able to create platforms through which probably businesses get transacted as well. But very importantly, the digital connect to your clients are so important today, more than the brick and mortar. You know? So it's an ever-changing, ever-evolving world where continual conversations with clients helps you to think ahead and start creating, planning, and you start strategizing and start reaching your goals. It's a very fast changing world today as against what it used to be 30 years back or 35 or 40 years back. So it's a very, very changing times. And this is where I also think that as an organization, we also have a mix of the young versus the old. You know, the young have the energy today to start thinking in a manner how you can change the way you are operating. And the old has the wisdom and the kind of knowledge and the kind of time that they have spent in to build the business. So when you have the right admix of the two, you have created a different ethos altogether. And that's what is actually driving our organization forward. You know, so end of the day, you have to be a problem solver. And through that, it starts pushing upwards. And from there, you start creating your plans and start strategizing it and start implementing it. So you can have a lot of plans, but if you don't have the ability to strategize and implement, implementation is even more important. And that's the sort of key that we have been kind of following over the years. So we create a base, grow to a large extent, and then start putting in our assets and start doing all those kind of things to have more customer connect.
to a certain extent, one thing I've seen in some organizations is once they've started to build the base, or once they've achieved something, comfort starts to settle in. And then even when there's younger talent trying to push in a new direction, there's some resistance. Yeah. So how do you manage that, both of those dynamics, where maybe the more tenured folks have the operational legacy, understand the business inside and out, and sometimes, you know, the inertia of change, the inertia of stability is so big that change becomes something that's daunting for them, while also empowering the younger folks to go ahead and push.
Absolutely. You know, change management is important. I think we truly believe that every day there is a need to change, actually. Yeah. You know, but it's true what you say, because there are times that you are faced with these sort of internal conflicts where sometimes if you find this is on an ongoing basis, where some of the older lot are unable to adapt and accept the changes that is really required, you keep giving them a few chances, you keep talking to them, but if some of them, not all, but some of them are stuck to their ways, then it's very difficult for them to run the race. And you will find that such people who are not willing to run the race fall by the wayside. And I'm not saying that we are an organization where we don't have that. We do have quite a number of them, because we do have conflicts like this, where there's a set of thinking that comes in. There is a set of people who think, oh, that's not the way it has to be done. But every time this iteration happens, and you will find that at the end of the day, out of a lot of conversations that we have, we will come back with the right solution. The journey has to be consistent. You know, the all the four wheels will have to be running at the same pace. Otherwise, you will have a problem. So when you have issues like this, where some of the older generation, it could be the other way around as well, you know. If somebody doesn't align their thoughts with the organizational goals, then the organization cannot close down and, you know, move away from it. That individual who doesn't find a place in the team will have to naturally find an exit. This happens on an ongoing basis. And that's why I think we don't even call it as human resource. We call it as human assets, actually. There's a lot of work that goes on a continual basis. There's a lot of mentoring that happens. There's a lot of coaching that happens. There's a lot of one-on-one interaction that happens. But there's something called as coffee with the chairman that we run in an organization, where in random we pick up people. You know, they have an ability every week to sit with me, talk to me. I talk to them all about their family, life, what they do. It motivates them. It energizes them. And when they go back, that's what they, you know, they ensure that they are passing that message across to their colleagues. And there's a lot of energy there, and that they all put it together and keep working. The question that you asked, this alignment or misalignment is a daily possibility. And that's something which is what you have to be prepared to deal with. It's not that who's right and who's wrong. But the organization goals will have to be met. And those who are not able to run along with that goal, along with the team, and if one is going to reduce the pace of the wheel, then the car collapses. So we cannot allow that to happen. So you need to be moderating it and ensuring that the pace is maintained at all times. It's a task by itself.
You know, it's impressive. You come across as a very, you know, powerful strategic thinker. But I love that you said something that's very important, which is implementation is equally, if not more important than the strategic thinking. What have you learned about driving implementation at scale? Because it's clear that you have these very big ideas and they span many different areas, but you're moving all of them forward. And so what have you learned about how to manage implementation at such a large scale across different segments?
You know, implementation, there is no two ways about it. It is the most important thing, you know. But I think to implement anything, the processes, you know, I think one needs to go through and have a comprehensive overhaul of your processes every now and then. Like I said at the beginning, it, like introspecting yourself, your own organization's process will have to be continually looked into. And there has to be a team that is evaluating how well-oiled the mechanism is. And that's something which has to be on an ongoing basis, because you find that time and again, what you thought is good today is not necessarily good tomorrow.
Mm.
And the process team has to be on top of all of this. And this is this is something which we learned, because when we were one of the very first organizations in the 80s or in the early 90s, when we ended up having a small little computer with a dot matrix printer to print out all the manifests and things like that. And then later on, much later in the beginning of the year 2000, we lost out in that race because we were one of the first to implement computerization.
Mm.
But much later, we discovered that we did not live up to that level.
Mm.
And that what we set it up at 1990 started seeing a decline in the year 2000 and onwards. Much later in 2007 and 8, we decided that most importantly is for us to continuously go on looking at our own process, keep on improving the way we do things. And that's something which is an ongoing exercise, and you can never let go of it. And if you have the processes right, implementation becomes a lot more easier.
Mm.
And if you forget about the processes and the people that are involved in it, forget it. No matter what you have as your dream, you can never implement it to the levels where you want it to be.
Yeah.
So I think evaluation of the process and having a very strong process and the delivery team is extremely important in any business. In anything, for that matter. And we have followed it like a mantra.
Yeah.
And we've had a very strong basis team looking at it.
Mm.
I'm not saying that it is 100% satisfactory just because it has been there.
Mm.
Every time these guys look at it, every time they come up with a new requirement. Today, your client's requirement may be A, and tomorrow's need may be C.
Mm.
So we may be sitting with something which is below A.
Yeah,
but that's not enough. You know, you've got to change again and again and start looking at your process and keep on improving to sort of build efficiency.
Yeah,
that is also a parallel ongoing exercise that has to happen.
Mm.
You know, without which your execution can go to you can think and dream and you can do anything.
Mm.
Your execution can be a big problem at that time.
Yeah,
and if execution is not smooth, and the processes are not driving it, then it becomes a drudgery for your client, not only for your customer, for your own internal family, internal employees who are working with you. To them, it's a drudgery using the whole process in the system.
Yeah.
So I think it's important that execution along with the process understanding is the key.
Yeah. So do you have kind of a process improvement or a project management team?
We do have a general manager who runs the entire process right across the organization.
Okay.
And he's continually looking and talking to each one of them.
Yeah.
Time and again, he's also speaking to the clients along with the sales team and the heads of the units, understanding what is really required and adapting it to the requirements. So that keeps the efficiency level very, very high.
Yeah.
I also want to make a quick mention while we talk about all of this.
Yeah.
I said at the beginning how important your human assets are.
Yeah.
As an organization, Transworld has been regarded as a great place to work for the last 5 years consecutively.
Mm.
And this year, I think we've come in as the 60th great place to work within Asia.
Mm.
I think to us, it's a great recognition because it comes from that organization who gauges people. And that's largely coming in from the feedback of your own internal employees. So you can't become a great place to work if you don't have a happy, satisfied team sitting in there as a family and working for you.
Mm.
So I think I'm very proud to say that that's been a phenomenal journey that we've had.
Yeah.
And it's the team.
Mm.
It's ultimately how you motivate the team. See, the leader is only as good as the team.
Mm.
I mean, I can come up and speak today so many things,
but
I wouldn't be anywhere near it if my team did not work along with me to deliver and live up to what I wanted.
Yeah.
And it is up to me to ensure that I'm providing them with the right kind of infrastructure, right kind of environment for them to work and start building the organization.
Mm.
To me, execution is the key. Process is very important. Like I said at the beginning, patience, persistence, perseverance, passion, all of these are very, very important mantras.
Yeah.
Integrity. You got to be absolutely true to whatever you do.
Yeah.
You have to start respecting people.
Yeah.
You have to start looking at people as human beings. And these are the values that we have in an organization. Yeah. Every individual will have to be respected. Customer centrality is a key theme that we have. You have to keep on doing everything that your customer is expecting you to do and even exceed from there. You have to have customer centrality. It's very, very important, actually. And excellence, one of the mantras that we have. Anything that we do it best. We do it as best as we can and keep on improving. And this improvement comes out of the process.
Yeah.
Execution happens along with it. So there's a lot of things that, I mean, today is a great day for me to sit and talk, because many times you're not really thinking, you're not looking at all of these things. You're in a journey, or you got your dream, you want to push yourself ahead, you know.
Yeah.
Today's conversation, Tariq, with you actually gives me an opportunity to go back and start rewinding my own thoughts and seeing how we have put the jigsaw puzzle together and where we have kind of reached in the last maybe 45, 46 years of being in business.
No, it's the difference between seeing the tree and the forest, right? Yes. When you're in the execution mode, it's it's difficult to see the broader picture, for sure. Eventually, Transworld gets to a point where there's a partial exit of the business. I'd love to hear more about that experience.
Yeah. You know, we've, as an organization, we have, we consider ourselves a Dubai organization, as a UAE grown organization. We have continually worked very closely with Port Rashid, the Dubai Ports World, and all of them over many, many years, along with the various other operators in India.
Yeah.
Now, as I said at the beginning, we sort of created an organization which was delivering with containers, and we were running ships in the various areas, again, connecting with the customers. So we've been sort of interacting for a while with DP World, and they have a great vision as well, where they don't want to be just people who are operating from a gate to gate. Yeah. They want to go even beyond the gates of the ports and start creating value for their clients. That's their vision. That's they want to be an enabler to global trade. That's their kind of dream. So they came up, and we've been sort of having a close relationship, and they came up and spoke to us a few years back and said that, hey, listen, you guys have a great model that you've built, because everything is so well integrated, stitched together. Would you all look like to be our partners? Would you like to be a partner with us? And we would like to invest into your business. So we sat down, and usually, you know, these things don't happen in one discussion or one conversation. So we had to go. First of all, we had to think as a family, something which I've put in a lot of effort to build over the last so many years. Are we doing the right thing to allow somebody else to come and be wanting to be a partner with us? You know, this was a big debate, actually, within the family, within the senior leadership. And then we came to a conclusion that whatever we have been able to build in this last 45, 46 years, there is a great amount of value. And why not? Why not we look at a good partner like a DP World and see how we can take it to a different level? So that triggered our thought that, yes, why not progress with the conversation? Start looking at this more closely. And then we had a few rounds of discussions with them. We sort of carved out the operational business, what we have, which I meant is the NVOCC business, where we run the containers. And we also run some of the business within the Indian coast. And we said that, okay, these are businesses that we can talk about. And then said they said, yes, let's take this out. We become your partners. You be our partners. You keep running the business with a clear understanding that our assets will always be used in the business that is being run. So to us, we have a right of first refusal. And we also have an ability to kind of partly exiting some of the businesses and having them as our partners in the business. So it's been a great journey. First time we did that. After a lot of thinking and talking and backwards and forwards, finally we hit the right formula. And very, very happy to have concluded that about two and a half years back with DP World. Been a great journey, actually. And that business continues to thrive. Thrive for them and thrive for us as well.
And what is that feeling like when you close a transaction like that, having spent a large percentage of your life, you know, focused on building the business?
Well, you know, it's not easy. First of all, I must say it's not easy to take a decision. Because you're very unsure, you know, what kind of a space that you're going to get into. But I think once you've got across that thought and you're very certain that what you're doing is the right thing for the business, for the people, and for the organization, and for the family, of course, you start detaching yourself a bit more and start looking at it from a distance. And that is not an easy exercise too, because like I said, every Tuesday we have a review meeting, we sit down and talk. When this conversation was on, almost 6 months before that, I started detaching myself from those regular Tuesday reviews, actually. And I wanted our people to continue to do what they had to do, because at some point of time, if we succeed in this, naturally I'm going to be sitting outside and, okay, remain to be a board member and all of that, you know, but that doesn't mean that I'm going to be putting my finger every day in the operations. So it was a journey that we had to go through. I don't think there's a fixed rule or a fixed way anybody would deal with it. I think each entrepreneur will have to find what is going to comfort him and what is his best way to sort of deal with these situations, actually. To us, it's been a great journey. First time we did that, and we found it extremely useful, very good. So we very well know that what we have created tomorrow is going to grow and become a huge business in times to come, you know. That's the kind of belief and confidence that we had, and that's how we moved ahead with that.
And for you personally, what's changed after that in terms of how you operate or what you do?
Well, nothing has changed. It's just that it allows you to have sufficient amount of capital available all the time in terms of your liquidity, etc., etc. You start looking at a new way of kind of identifying, just as you said at the beginning, we kind of look at many startups. You know, interesting. The idea is to have conversations. It's not that every startup is exciting, you know, but when you keep talking to entrepreneurs, and it's also, I love sitting and talking to these young entrepreneurs, you know, when they come up with those flashy ideas, great ideas, not all of them are success, but I learn from them. It's like a reverse mentoring. I learn a lot from these youngsters who come in. And then when we find that there's anything that is interesting, which we believe has got a great opportunity, we also go in and start investing into those vehicles and continue to support them. That's where this handholding happens. That's where we start working very closely with them. And it keeps me busy with all of that. Plus, the logistic business is still, as far as I see it, is a business which is still growing. And sort of we believe that there's a lot of effort that needs to go in. My son Ritesh is looking after the operations. He's strongly anchored into all of these things. Anisha is involved in a lot of corporate responsibility areas, and she runs the family office that we have. So the children are also very clearly, in terms of their responsibility, in terms of the succession and all of that, is very clearly identified. They both of them, actually, I must also say that have greatly imbibed all these values and virtues that I was talking about. And they all continue to drive as the next generation, also in a manner which makes me extremely proud. And I see them driving all of this with the same level of passion, same level of commitment, same level of persistence. And that gives me great level of confidence. And I am very, very happy looking at new projects, new ideas. What do we want to do? Like I just mentioned, we're getting into the tanker business. So many, many new ideas keep cropping up. And this is also a consequence of our being able to talk to many of our clients. And they come and tell you, this is what we're looking at. We're looking at food processing as a business in India. We believe food security is an extremely important aspect of an expectation in this region in any way. So we are working very, very hard to set up a phenomenally strong, powerful food processing unit in India, which will continually be able to support and becomes a good business model for us. We're looking at various other opportunities, you know, in here and also in India. Continually keep evaluating, keep seeing what we have to do, and keep moving. We can't remain stagnant. And we got to keep moving, keep moving, keep moving at our own pace. That's why I said, you know, you got to move your goalpost all the time. And I do that myself, you know, so you're not going to be sitting down and saying, oh, you reached what you wanted to, and I'm happy to sit and spend my time at home. You know, that's not the way it works. So you got to keep pushing yourself.
You know, one thing that came up when I was talking to your children about questions for today's session was your ability to maintain good balance in work and life. And so I'd love to learn a little bit more about how you, what your daily rituals look like, how you organize yourself.
You know, I follow a very simple theory for this.
Yeah.
I sort of, it's like spokes in a wheel, actually.
Mm.
And I sort of spoke it with about six separate spokes in a wheel.
Mm.
One is your professional, one is your personal, three is your family, four is your health, friends, and then, you know, nourishing your knowledge. All of this is something which is a spiritual side of life,
mm.
and a physical side of life, where you do a lot of these workouts, exercises, and things like that, you know. So what I do is take the wheel, split that into different spokes, and put it very clearly, what are those priority areas?
Mm.
And every part of the wheel has to be nourished.
Mm.
For example, again, like I said, if you are going to be excessively in the spiritual side and ignoring your friends, for that matter, or if you're excessively in the field of physical exercises and forgetting about a lot of other aspects of life, you'll find the wheel suddenly starts breaking.
Yeah.
You know, it doesn't remain strong to go keep moving. So you have to nurture all of this. And it's an important thing. You know, for example, travel. You want to be with your family, for instance. You want to be, let's say, updated. You want to be in the space of keeping updated with the knowledge, changes that's happening environmentally outside. You want to be very fit physically. You know, all of these things have to be balanced out.
Mm.
And then you could bring out this work, life balance, etc., etc. I must say that, you know, at the end of the day, if one is going to look at excessively only working, it's exciting when you're young. You know, I also did the same thing, but yeah. I can say this at my age, after I've gained the wisdom that it's important to have a balance in life.
Mm.
One cannot take over as an overdriving priority over the others. I think everything has to be in a balance.
Mm.
Everything needs to be put in the wheel, mm. and the wheel has to be extremely well balanced.
Mm.
Then I think you will find that equation that's needed to keep your life in a more meaningful way.
Yeah,
I think it's something, again, you learn.
Mm.
I sort of was the same, you know, when I used to run endlessly, you know, every day taking a flight, you going here and there, and not really bothering and spending enough time when I should have. But the inverse of that is probably if you didn't do all of that, maybe you would not have seen the kind of success, whatever you've seen over the period of time.
Yeah.
Sooner one learns to balance, I think it's better for them.
Mm.
Because in these days of burnouts, which you keep hearing so often, it is necessary that you find a life balance that works. Mm. There is no, again, a fixed formula for it. Each one will have to find what works for them.
Mm.
But importantly, it has to be balanced.
Mm.
How do you find that as a balance is something which each one will have to work hard and identify.
Yeah.
You know,
yeah.
But there cannot be anything in excess. It has to be well balanced.
Mm.
That's what I found over so many years. And that's not the mantra that I've been following.
Mm.
I have my ritual every morning. I have my my prayer session. Mm. Then I have a trainer comes home, you know, 4 to 5 days a week. Without fail, I do my physical exercises. Even if I travel, I go through with that. I have my set of friends, not too many, but whoever I have, keep meeting them, keep spending sufficient amount of time with them, keep reading, keep myself updated with whatever is happening in the world, spend a lot of time with my team, keep talking to them, keep sort of reflecting ideas, keep sharing thoughts, all of that happens. Spend a lot of great time with my grandson, a lot of time with Ritesh and Anisha, along with my wife. We have a great time. We go on family holidays. It all has come over a period of time.
Yeah.
But now it has come to a stage where it's very, very well balanced.
Mm.
And I don't wish to change that at all at any point of time.
Mm.
I don't wish to trade that for anything else.
Yeah.
And I think it's extremely important when it comes to real life, because health is very important.
Mm. Mm. Mm.
And you can't become a burden to anyone, for that matter.
Mm.
So you've got to take care of yourself. And that only comes with the way you balance your life.
Yeah.
They're like, there is no fixed formula again. There's no fixed way you do. You have to find your own. But I think the great model that you can look at is this wheel.
Yeah.
Put it all down in six different perspectives and keep nurturing all of them in a well-balanced manner and see how you're doing.
Yeah.
6 months later, you evaluate it. Has it worked for you? If not, what do I do next?
Mm.
3 months later, again, look at it. Oh, this I'm doing too much. Oh, this I must cut it down. This is something which I'm doing too less. bring it up. So you can easily balance it out in a manner you look at it.
Yeah.
In a very clear way. You mm-hmm. shouldn't be getting biased about it. You have to be very open about it and keep doing it.
Yeah. I heard you say a couple of things in our discussion today. One, this idea of having to have passion, persistence, perseverance. I love this idea of, you know, making sure that a person delivers what they promise. I think that's a forgotten characteristic in this day and age. I love this idea that kept coming up that when you sit with clients, that will drive change if you have a problem solver mentality. Right. I definitely will walk away thinking about this continuous execution and process implementation at scale and how using that will help drive an organization. In leadership, I think many organizations forget that at the end of the day, treating people like human beings is the most important Absolutely. Leadership characteristic. And I love this idea of looking at life in the context of spokes in a wheel and making sure that they're balanced. So I personally have learned a lot from our conversation today, Mr. Ramesh, and I just want to say thank you very much for sharing your time and wisdom with us today.
Tariq, thank you so much. It is a pleasure. And I enjoyed this conversation with you. And I look forward to meeting up with you. And if you need anything, I'm always available. Please feel free to reach out to me. Thank you so much.
I appreciate that. Thank you very much.